Hello, everybody. This is Brother Luke, Sin City Preacher. Welcome to this episode of Bible Talk with Brother Luke. Today I'm going to continue in the study of the book of Acts, and I'm going to begin today with chapter 22, verse 1. If you have not seen all the previous studies on Acts, I urge you to go back and watch this study from the beginning. All the other videos are uploaded and available on my YouTube channel, Sin City Preacher. This is one of the most important studies that I've ever done. The book of Acts is a history of the first 30 years of the church, and some very important truths can be discovered by studying the book of Acts. But right now, I'll give you just a little bit of context and then begin with chapter 22. The Apostle Paul now has gone to Jerusalem. He was warned not to go to Jerusalem by a prophet. He was told that he would be arrested and imprisoned if he did. And Paul says that he must do it. He's led by the Holy Spirit to do it. And while there, he's confronted by James and the elders of the Jerusalem church about his teaching that Judaism must be discarded, that people should not practice Judaism. Believers should simply have their faith in Jesus as their Savior, and that circumcision, the dietary laws, all the Mosaic laws, temple worship, animal sacrifices, all these things that the Jewish believers were continuing to do. By the way, this is about 22 or 23 years past Pentecost. So what's happened since Pentecost is about 3 years after Pentecost, Stephen was martyred. About 6 years past Pentecost, the Apostle Paul was converted. About 10 years past Pentecost, the first Gentile believers occurred. The Apostle Peter was called by God to be the first one to preach to the Gentiles. He was sent to preach to Cornelius and his family. Cornelius and his family were the first Gentile believers. Many years past Pentecost, where Paul started his first missionary journey, then his second missionary journey, then his third missionary journey, and now he's compelled to go to Jerusalem, and he's confronted for his what they believe is his false teaching that Judaism should be discarded. He's telling the Jews to not practice Judaism, and now you've got, he's preached in the temple. He was ordered by James and the elders to go to the temple and do some ritual thing. I don't know if Paul himself had to shave his head, but he was to go with two people who were to shave their head and go through a ritual. And so he's commanded to do some legalistic thing. And Paul, rather than standing up against James, he goes along with it, and that's a mystery to me why he didn't stand up to him at that time. But he did go to the temple, and now there's a riot taking place because they're confronting Paul again for teaching the Jews not to follow Judaism. Because of this riot that's taking place, and they're wanting to murder Paul, you have the Roman authorities take Paul and into custody, to protective custody, and then you have Paul asking them, before you take me, let me speak to the Jews who want to kill him. So that's what's happening now. Chapter 22, verse 1. In the KJV, Paul says, "Men, brethren, and fathers, hear ye my defense, which I make now unto you. And when they heard that he spake in the Hebrew tongue to them, they kept the more silence, and he saith, I am verily a man, which am a Jew, born in Tarsus, a city in Cilicia, yet brought up in this city at the feet of Gamaliel, and taught according to the perfect manner of the law of the fathers, and was zealous toward God, as ye all are this day. So he's giving his credentials, that he was a Jew, he's highly educated, he studied at the feet of Gamaliel, who was perhaps the most respected Jewish theologian and teacher, rabbi at that time. Paul was his protege, so he says, I was brought up to be zealous for the law, just as you are. Let me read I also like to read, not only in the KJV as the scriptures, but I like to read in the Amplified as a commentary and translation. Sometimes it's helpful. Verse 1 through 3 in the Amplified says, Brethren and fathers, that's kinsmen, hear my defense which I now offer you. When they heard that he was addressing them in the Hebrew dialect, they became even more quiet, and he continued, I am a Jew, born in Tarsus of Cilicia, but brought up in this city, educated at the feet of Gamaliel. He's brought up in Jerusalem, is where he is. Educated at the feet of Gamaliel. Now there's a footnote here about Gamaliel. Let me see what it says here. According to the Talmud, Gamaliel, who was the leading scholar of the Torah from AD 20 to 40, taught a school of 1,000 advanced students. Educated at the feet of Gamaliel according to the strictness of the law of our fathers, being ardent and passionate for God, just as all of you are today. Now back to the KJV, beginning with verse 4. And I persecuted this way. The term this way is the original title or name, description of the Christian believers. What it was considered in the very beginning was a new sect of Judaism. Jews who now believed the Messiah did come and it was Jesus. But they were still practicing Judaism. The two things that were erroneous at the beginning of the church that had to be corrected was the Jews believed that the Messiah, the Savior, Jesus, came only for the Jews. It was revealed to them that God told Peter to go preach to the Gentiles, and then Paul was designated to preach to the Gentiles. So this relationship with Jesus as your Savior was not only for the Jews, but also for the Gentiles, for the whole world. And the second error that they held that needed to be corrected was that the practicing of Judaism and the law was to continue. So this new faith called the Way, they thought that it was practicing Judaism and believing in Jesus. But they had to be corrected and realize that no, it's not the law and faith in Jesus. Law is discarded. Judaism is discarded. You must no longer follow the Mosaic laws as a religion, as a thinking that somehow salvation is a formula, A plus B equals C. Practicing religious works of the works of Judaism plus faith in Jesus as your Messiah equals salvation. No, it's not a formula of works plus faith. It is faith alone. In Christ alone gives you salvation. So this is something that they didn't understand in the beginning, and gradually, particularly in, we see that also in the preaching of Peter, all through the book of Acts, and we also see it in the preaching of Paul, and particularly in all of Paul's letters, we see this clarification that salvation is by faith alone in Christ alone, no religious works are required, and if you're practicing Judaism, you need to no longer put your faith in following the religion of Judaism. That is to be left behind. So, he says, and I persecuted this way. The reason I went on that tangent is because the term this way was the original name of or identification of the believers, who the Jewish believers who believed Jesus was their Messiah. Later on in Antioch, about 10 years after Pentecost, it says that in Antioch, the title Christian began to be used to identify this new sect. Verse 4, and I persecuted this way unto the death. So he persecuted the new believers unto their death. He caused the death. He was responsible for the death of these new believers. He says, binding and delivering into prisons both men and women. Paul is his Roman name, but he was Saul of Tarsus, a very religious Jew in the Pharisee, and he was appointed, he was given authority to round up all of these new believers that were the Jewish authorities considered them to be heretics, and they should be imprisoned and executed. Paul was appointed as the one to round them up and imprison them and kill them. And that's what he's describing here. He says, I persecute this way unto the death, binding and delivering into prisons both men and women, as also the high priest doth bear me witness, and all the estate of the elders, from whom also I received letters unto the brethren, and went to Damascus. The letters unto the brethren is the letters is a decree giving him the title and authority to persecute, to round them up and arrest them, the believers. And I received letters unto the brethren and went to Damascus to bring them which were there bound unto Jerusalem for to be punished. And it came to pass that as I made my journey and was come nigh unto Damascus about noon, suddenly there shone from heaven a great light round about me. And I fell unto the ground and heard a voice saying unto me, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? He's giving this account, which he's given. This is at least the second or third time I recall that he's given this account of this experience, the road to Damascus, Paul's conversion. And so this great light appears and he hears this voice. It's the voice of Jesus saying, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And I answered, Who art thou, Lord? And he said unto me, I am Jesus of Nazareth, whom thou persecutest. And they that were with me saw indeed the light. So they don't see Jesus, but they see this blinding light. It did literally blind Paul. And were afraid, but they heard not the voice of him that spake to me. In another account, I think Paul says that they heard it as a sound of thunder. So Paul clearly hears the voice of Jesus. In verse 10, and I said, What shall I do, Lord? And the Lord said unto me, Arise and go into Damascus, and there it shall be told thee of all things which are appointed for thee to do. And when I could not see for the glory of that light, Paul was blinded, being led by the hand of them that were with me, I came into Damascus. And one Ananias, a devout man according to the law, so this is a Jewish believer who followed the laws of Judaism, having a good report of all the Jews which dwelt there, came unto me and stood and said unto me, Brother Saul, receive thy sight. And the same hour I looked up upon him. And he said, The God of our fathers hath chosen thee, that thou shouldest know his will and see that just one, Jesus, and shouldest hear the voice of his mouth. For thou shalt be his witness unto all men of what thou hast seen and heard. And now, why tarriest thou? Arise and be baptized, and wash away thy sins, calling on the name of the Lord. Now this, verse 16, be baptized and wash away thy sins, this could be a real problem text for all of us who believe that salvation is by faith alone in Christ alone. No religious works are required, including the work of water baptism. So I've covered this to a great extent in the previous chapters, but this verse here brings up the subject again. So if you think that he needed to be water baptized in order to be saved, this is a damnable heresy. You're saved when you put your faith in Jesus, and the water baptism is a ritual, a ceremony that we should go through after we get saved, as a public statement, which is symbolic of our sins being washed away and the new birth. It's symbolic of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus and us being in Christ and our death and resurrection as a new creature in Christ. Now, verse 17, and it came to pass that when I was come again to Jerusalem, even while I prayed in the temple, I was in a trance and saw him saying unto me, Make haste and get thee quickly out of Jerusalem, for they will not receive thy testimony concerning me. And I said, Lord, they know that I imprisoned and beat in every synagogue them that believed on thee. And when the blood of thy martyr Stephen was shed, I also was standing by and consenting unto his death, and kept the raiment of them that slew him. So he's given this account of his whole experience of persecuting the church, his conversion on the road to Damascus, and then him beginning his preaching, and he's told to go preach even in the synagogue that's right here. What are you delaying? Go preach right now. Tell them about Jesus. And he's saying, everybody is very much aware that I am the one that was persecuting them. So he's told to go preach to them in spite of this. Verse 21, and he said unto me, Depart, for I will send thee far hence unto the Gentiles. Verse 22, and they gave him audience unto his word, and then lifted up their voices and said, Away with such a fellow from the earth, for it is not fit that he should live. And as they cried and cast off their clothes and threw dust into the air. Now this scene here is not the continuous of Paul recounting his experiences. We're back in Jerusalem, and this is the reaction of the people to Paul's speech he just gave them. They're not persuaded by Paul's words. They're enraged, and they are saying, away with such a fellow. So they're still very angry at Paul. They hate him, and they're saying, away with him. It's not fit for that he should live. They're saying, let's kill him. Verse 24, and the chief captain commanded him to be brought into the castle and bade that he should be examined by scourging. Examined by scourging is beaten with a whip. That's a way of examining someone. That's a way of getting the truth out of them. Well, that he might know wherefore they cried so against him. So the chief captain, that was his plan. Let's take him, take the castle, let's beat him and get the truth out of him. Verse 25, and as they bound him with thongs, so this is when they bind him with thongs, this is the fulfillment of that prophecy from the prophet in the previous chapters that warned Paul, if you go to Jerusalem, this is what's going to happen to you. You'll be bound and jailed. And Paul said, at this time, as soon as they arrest him, Paul said unto the centurion that stood by, is it lawful for you to scourge a man that is a Roman and uncondemned? Paul's very much aware that it's unlawful to do that. Rather than decree, you can't scourge me because I'm a Roman citizen. I have my rights. He didn't say that. He wasn't demand it. He's very cleverly putting the thought and said, wait, is it okay for you guys to scourge me and arrest me like this since I'm a Roman citizen? Is it lawful that you for you to scourge a man that is a Roman and uncondemned? That means he hasn't had a trial, hasn't been found guilty. Verse 26, when the centurion heard that, he went and told the chief captain, saying, take heed what thou doest, for this man is a Roman. So now they're all afraid by Paul's claim, because if they do scourge and treat him in this way, if the fact is true that he is a Roman citizen, they will pay a price for mistreating a Roman citizen and not honoring his rights that he has as a Roman citizen. So the chief captain came and said unto him, tell me, art thou a Roman? Paul said, yea, yes. And of course, if someone claims to be a Roman citizen when they're not, that's a serious offense too. I don't know what the penalty is, but I imagine it would be a very, very severe penalty claiming that you're Roman when you're not. Verse 28, and the chief captain answered, with a great sum obtained I this freedom. And Paul said, but I was freeborn. So the chief captain said he bought his freedom with a great sum of money. And Paul says, no, but I was born a free man. Verse 29, then straightway they departed from him which should have examined him. So they changed their mind. They were not going to, scourge and examine him that way. And the chief captain also was afraid after he knew that he was a Roman and because he had bound him. So he's afraid they've already mistreated him. As a Roman citizen, he has rights. They should not have even bound him in that way. Verse 30, on the morrow, because he would have known the certainty wherefore he was accused of the Jews, he loosed him from his bands and commanded the chief priests and all their council to appear and brought Paul down and set him before them. I'm just going to read the final verse in the Amplified, see how it's stated. But on the morrow, wanting to know the real reason why Paul was accused by the Jews, he released him and ordered the chief priests and the whole council, the Sanhedrin, the Jewish High Court, to assemble and brought Paul down and presented him before them. So in this next chapter, this is going to continue where the chief captain and Paul and the Sanhedrin, the chief captain wants to get to the bottom of what's really going on here. All right, so that's the end of chapter 22. And I will pick this up in chapter 23 next time. Thank you for watching. Bless you all in the name of our great Savior God, Jesus Christ.